Hi everyone, welcome back to the channel and welcome to part 3 of chapter 6 of CA Final ISCA syllabus. This is the last part of this chapter and here we'll be covering from heading 6.6 to 6.9. In this chapter, it is all connected with chapter 3, which deals with protection of information systems. There's a lot of connection between this part and that chapter. First, we'll look at the role of IS auditor in physical controls. There are three things which he will have to do. First one, he will have to assess that the risk assessment done by the organization is sufficient enough. Next, he'll have to check the controls regarding physical access, whether they are adequate or not. Third one would be to review the documentation that has been maintained by the organization, to check whether those controls are operating as expected, whether their design and implementation was as expected or not. Next, we'll look at the environment related controls. If you look here, it's all like something like weird, and it's not something which you will be wanting to study as from an exam point of view. Just go through these things. They might be useful for multiple choice, but theory based question, I doubt they'll be asking you anything from this part regarding environment controls. You will have to look at these two things, which are very important from multiple choice point of view. Mean time between failures, that is MTBF, and mean time to repair, that is MTTR. These two are important expansions which may be asked for the multiple choice part. And in this table, they have given what are the exposures or environment related risks, what are the controls that are implemented by organization. A third point talks about what are the audit procedures which the auditor has done in order to satisfy himself about the working of the control. Next, we have managerial controls and their audit trails. If you look at chapter 3, page number 3.38 to 3.47, they have given the same points but from management viewpoints or management perspective, and in this chapter, which is chapter 6, they talk about it from the viewpoint of the auditor. And as far as theory questions from these parts go, I doubt they'll be asking you any kind of theory questions from this part, because even if they ask you, you can still leverage what you learnt in chapter 3 and just change the viewpoint from the management to the auditor. In this table, they have given about the 8 controls or 8 categories of controls in the management, from the management point of view. This is again coming from chapter 3 itself. And in the next 2 or 3 pages, they have talked about these same controls but from the viewpoint of the auditor. What should the auditor be doing in each of these stages? And the function of the top management would be that of planning, organizing, leading and control. And what does the auditor do in each of these stages has been talked about here. In planning, he'll have to see whether the plan is appropriate or not. In organizing, he will see how good is the knowledge of the staff, whether the employees are ethical or not, or whether they are against the organization or for the organization. In leading, he will see how well the top management is functioning as a team of leaders, whether the employees are happy with that or not. And in control, he'll see how good is the management from viewpoint of control of the systems, whether they're having good control points or whether the control is lackadaisical. Next, we have system development management controls. In system development, when we look at chapter 3, we'll note that it has to pass through a number of stages, that is user specification, then authorization, technical design, and after that the internal auditor gets involved in it. Then the system team will give their go ahead and user will finally accept. So in each of these stages, what is the role of the auditor? That is what is talked about here. Concurrent audit, meaning he will be continuously involved with the design team and the testing team whenever they are implementing that or whenever they are developing new systems. And post implementation, he'll have to see how good is the implementation of that system, whether there are any changes that are needed to the system. General audit is usually done by the external auditor, not by the internal auditor. The objective in a general audit would be to just check or leverage the work of the internal auditor to check the impact on the financials. And in general audit, nothing much is done apart from that. Then the next one would be regarding program management. If you look at chapter 3, you will note that in programming, there are these stages, that is, come up with a plan, then design the program, code the program, test it, then implement and maintain it, and control points at each of these stages. So in this table, they have talked about how the auditor is involved in each of these stages, and the auditor will have to evaluate how the plans are made. He will have to evaluate whether the controls are operating reliably or not. He should check the design, whether it is suitable or not. Then he should check the codes, whether they have been implemented as per the design and as per the standards. Then he can interview the testers to understand whether they have tested it properly or not. And he will have to check on the operation and maintenance part regarding whether the programs are operating as intended or whether they need any more maintenance. And then in data resource management, he'll have to check whether controls are there to maintain data integrity and whether the data access and update controls work properly or not. And in quality assurance, he'll have to interview the quality team regarding how they are maintaining quality. Do they know about the quality standards? What do they take measures in order to implement quality and things like that. In security management, he will have to evaluate whether the security reviews are working as per plan or not, whether there is a disaster recovery plan in place, whether insurance plans or insurance policies are taken against the assets or not. And then we move on to operation management controls, where he'll have to see how the organization's operations are carried on and whether the activities or documentation and things like that are going on properly or not. The thing about all these is you can just refer chapter 3, and once you get an understanding of what each of these 8 controls are, you can write on your own what the auditor will have to do. For everything, the auditor will have to just check and check things. So if you know what is there in those controls, you can write auditor will have to check this, he'll have to check that. And I don't expect much of questions coming in from this part as well, because the most questions would come from chapter 3 itself on all these parts, and chapter 6 questions usually come from the first and the second part, which we discussed in the earlier videos. So regarding these parts, we don't expect much questions to come. Now we move on to application controls and their audit trails. There are 6 application controls, which are again discussed as part of chapter 3. But here what we have to discuss is regarding the accounting audit trail and operation audit trail. So you'll have to know the meanings first. Accounting audit trail, it is a kind of a regular audit trail or a transaction log. It'll only maintain a record of the events in a chronological order. So if you log into a system, that system log would record that user ID so and so logged in at this point of time and whatever with this password or with this whatever with this device or system, and all those things will be logged in the accounting audit trail. In operations audit trail, it'll log in how much resources of the system have you been using. So if you use the organization server for 10 seconds, it will note that this person has used it for 10 seconds, consumed this much memory, used this much power and things like that. In each of these controls, we look at accounting audit trail and operations audit trail. First one is regarding boundary controls. In boundary controls, the meaning itself suggests that it is a control over the boundary. So we will have to see who logged in, what is the password and username which they have logged in, what is the device, how many attempts did they take to log in, when did they start and finish. These kind of things come in the accounting trail, and in the operations trail, it talks about how much system resources they have used. In input trail, we look at How long have they taken to enter the things? What is the source of the document which they are entering? Then who is the user who has entered it? When was it entered? What is the detail of transaction? In operations trail, we look at things like how long it had taken, what is the number of errors that were made, and things like that. Third one is regarding communication controls. In accounting trails, we look at what are the nodes or the devices which were used in the communication process. What was the message? When was it sent? In the operations trail, we look at the number of messages that have been sent, the length of the message, the system restarts, how long has it taken to send, what are the resources that were consumed. In the processing controls, in the accounting trail, we trace the transactions that have been processed in the system. And in the operations trail, we look at what is the CPU usage that it has taken to process that, and whether we can reconstruct that particular processing. In the database controls, we look at who modified the database, when was it modified, what was the modification that was made. And in the operations trail, we look at how much resources have been consumed in order to make that modification. And in the output, we will see what is the output that was presented, who was the one who received the output, when was it received. And in the operations trail, we again maintain a resource, or we maintain records of resources consumed and the CPU usage of that. So all this, you can just go through it once. I don't think it is very important from the exam point of view, and it is quite tough to remember it entirely as well. So just remember few points in this accounting and operations trail. As long as you understand the definition of accounting trail and operations trail, you can just think of that scenario practically when you are writing the exam, and then and there itself you can make up the answer and give it. Now we come to the last part of this chapter, that is audit of application security controls. We've got three layers here to discuss. The bottommost layer is the operational layer, the middle level is the tactical one, and the top one is a strategic layer. We look at what are the issues that we face at each of these layers. At the bottommost layer, we have three issues which we face, that is regarding the user accounts and access rights, password related controls, and segregation of duties. You can remember it as UPS. At this user accounts and access rights, this issue is that we need to have a record. We need to be able to identify who is the one who is using the system and resources. And we also need to identify what is the level of access rights that they require. What is the level of authorizations that they require? That is the issue which is being looked at here. We need to be able to identify who is the one using and what is the level of authorization that is to be given to them. The next one is regarding password controls. Here, this depends on the password policy of the organization. That is, what kind of passwords are the employees allowed to keep. They would have controls regarding the password age and the password length, the characters that are to be used in the password, the fact that it should not be repeated, like the same password cannot be repeated again and again for a particular period of time, and automated locking out of the system after a few failed attempts. All these things have to be built into password controls. The third one would be about segregation of duties. This is again things which we look at the operational level itself. They have given certain examples for that as well. That is, segregation of duties is something where the person who does one act in a process cannot be given access to another complementary act of the process. That is, if he gets access to both entering transaction as well as approval of the transaction, which are complementary to each other. It is a kind of huge access that he gets, and manipulation of things becomes easy. So that is why we implement segregation of duties. They have given examples here, which are again simple to understand. Now we move on to the second layer, which is the tactical layer. Here we have three issues again, and you can use the code word AML-ISRM. AML stands for audit, logging and monitoring, or audit, monitoring and logging. Here the audit logs have to be monitored frequently. If the audit logs are just sitting as audit logs and no one is monitoring, then there is no point of keeping audit logs itself. And audit logs are monitored not by the operational personnel, but by the middle-level management. That's why it comes under the tactical layer. The next one is regarding IS, which is interface security. At the operational level, we only look at each application on a standalone basis. So if we look at the payroll application in an organization, we only look at payroll application. We don't look at the production related applications or the other security related applications. But at the tactical level, we need to look at multiple applications on a holistic basis. Each application will interact with other applications, and finally everything flows into the ERP of the organization. Therefore, it is necessary that at this interface stage between different applications, security controls have to be provided so that data is entered properly and only authorized data gets entered. Whatever data is unauthorized should not make its way into this ERP through this loophole of security. Only data which is there in that application should interact with other applications and enter. Then the third one would be about IT risk management. You can remember about 2-3 points here. This is IT risk management, again looking at all the applications on a holistic basis. Assessing risk over the key application controls, giving security awareness to the employees. These are 2 points which you can remember for this particular IT risk management point. And now we come to the top layer, that is the strategic layer. And this strategic layer, we talk about the top management. They are the ones who are responsible for making the security policy, designing the training programs, providing security guidelines, and also mechanism for reporting of any security related issues. So all these four have to be in harmony with the objectives of the organization, and in case any of these fails, then the other two layers, that is the tactical and operational level layers, they also will end up invariably failing, because at the top level, the policy is itself not proper. Therefore, it's not possible for the lower levels to make up for that. So that is the issues which we talk about at the strategic layer. With that, we've come to an end of chapter number 6 of CA Final ISCA syllabus. Hope you had a good revision from this video of chapter 6, and hope you also will watch the further videos in the channel as well. Thank you for watching.